بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله once again we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the favors, the bounties that He has bestowed upon us, because indeed every single day is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's a reason why it's called a prison, because it is a prison, a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we place salawat and taslim upon the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a means of barakah, so that it may grant us the blessings from the Rabbah alayhi sallam, that he responds to us and he gives us salawat, as well as the hadith of the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had mentioned. Alhamdulillah, brothers and sisters Islam, we have come very far, and today inshallah ta'ala we continue with speaking about the seerah of the Nabi alayhi sallam, and specifically the part where the Nabi alayhi sallam is now completely boycotted from Quraysh. So we know that in the last session we spoke about how Quraysh tried all of the tricks with the Nabi alayhi sallam in trying to convince him to leave off this message, this da'wah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by offering him power, offering him money, offering him status, offering him wealth, women, all of these different things. But you see, the mistake was that the Nabi alayhi sallam, this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not the deen that is objective at the end of the day is the dunya, but its objective is the akhirah. It's the year after, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا بَتَاعٌ وَإِنَّ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ دَارُ الْقَرَارِ. Then indeed this dunya, it is but يعني, pleasure. It is in some ayat, some ahadith mentioned as an illusion. But the akhirah, the year after, the day of judgment, those are when the real things are going to start. And that is when you're going to have that eternal life with no ending to it. And either in the Jannah, or may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, in Jahannam. So Quraysh, trying all of these different methods, sending Rabi'ah to the Nabi alayhi sallam and some of the other people, Sadat bin Quraysh, the leaders and the chiefs of Quraysh, and they tried all of these different tricks with the Nabi alayhi sallam, but nothing came true. We know that one occasion where they asked Abu Talib to speak to the Nabi alayhi sallam, to tell him to leave off this message, and he said, if they had to put the moon in my right, the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand, I would never leave this message. Why? Because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has is much more than what creation can offer, because creator, he is the creator of creation, and he is the creator of limitations upon us, and there's no limit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now what happens? Quraysh sees that there's absolutely no way by trying to convince the Nabi alayhi sallam to leave off this message. They then decide with themselves, all of the Sadat, the chiefs and the leaders of Quraysh, they decide to all come together and have a boycott upon the Nabi alayhi sallam, but not only him, but his family. Why? Because they try to convince the family of the Nabi alayhi sallam as well to give him up, so that they may deal with him, so they may kill him. And of course, within the Arabs, yani, they had the tradition of standing up with family no matter what. So it's within them that they stand. So indirectly, Quraysh is actually going against what their traditions were built upon. So it's an innovation to ask Banu Abdul Muttalib and Banu Hashim to actually give over the Nabi alayhi sallam, because they know that Arabs stood for their family no matter what. So that never worked. What happens now? Quraysh decides to have a boycott upon the family and the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Banu Hashim and Banu Abdul Muttalib. And also to this whole experience, the Sahaba as well is affected by it. And we'll go through the points inshallah ta'ala as we go through it. What happens now? Quraysh decides to have this boycott, so they get a paper and they all decide to write down exactly what is going to happen with the family of the Nabi alayhi sallam. So the first thing they write in there in the paper, Allah yunakihahum, that nobody will get married to any of their women, any of the Muslim women. It is haram now for Quraysh to get married to any of the Muslim women. And this is also one of the reasons why we find that, for instance, the daughters of the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were married to their cousins, Abu Lahab, his uncle's sons, Ruqayya and Umm Kulthum. And this is how we see of the examples of Quraysh cutting themselves off from the Muslimin when Abu Lahab then orders his sons to divorce their wives, and those are the daughters of the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Though we find that they were replaced with much more better. Who was that? Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. The thalith khulafa al-Rashideen, the third most rightly guided khalifa in our deen, alhamdulillah. Second thing was Allah yubayahum, that nobody sells or buy anything from the Muslimin. Meaning we're going to boycott them also in order for them to not even gain sustenance, in order for them not to even feed their families. And what used to happen as well is that when Sahaba, the companions of the Rabbi alayhi salam, would try to also buy things, they would raise the prices so high that it's impossible for them to sell or buy anything. And that's why one of the riwayat, the narrations mentioned that Abu Lahab will be standing in the market area, and when they see any of the Ashab of the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam trying to buy something, he would then shout out loud and he says, يا معشر التجار غالوا على أصحاب محمد حتى لا يدركوا شيئا معكم. That he would shout and he would make a point of going to each and every Tajir businessman and telling them that make the prices high for the companions of Muhammad so that they may not buy anything from you. So it was complete seclusion. They wanted to cut off the Nabi alayhi salam and the Sahaba. And also they said, وَلَا يَقْبِلُوا مِنْهُمْ صُلْحًا وَلَا تَأْخُذْ بِهِمْ رَأْفَةٌ وَلَا يُجَالِسُهُمْ أَحَدٌ. That nobody can accept any goodness from them and never try to reconcile with them. And nobody can be or show any mercy or compassion towards them. And nobody can sit with them, meaning speak with them. So it was not only financial, but it was also social, because both social and financial they were completely cut off, and they were also put out of their own lands, that they had to be outside Makkah with this boycott that happened upon Banu Hashim and Banu Abdul Muttalib. And the condition was so severe that some of the riwayat mentions that for 3 years, some ulama say two, majority of the ulama say three, that for 3 years, the Nabi alayhi salam and his family, the blessed family of the Nabi alayhi salam, they went through so drastic times that a lot of them had to eat even the leaves, the dry leaves of the tree. And now we know that it's not like it's going to be fruitful like we find in the jungles. No, we're talking about the middle of the desert. So we really know how dry, how hard these plants are, and these are the things that the Sahaba, the Nabi alayhi salam and his family had to eat in order to survive for 3 years. Can you imagine, Jamaat al-Muslimin, the seriousness of this occasion, at least this dramatic occasion that the Nabi alayhi salam and his family went through. And it is said that the person that wrote down the Sahifa, the paper, and of course they took that paper and they placed it upon the door of the Kaaba. The person that wrote this, his name was Mansur ibn Ikrimah. And it is said that not long after that, Mansur ibn Ikrimah's hands could not use anymore. It just one day completely became useless and he could not anymore use his hands. It became numb and it was useless afterwards. And of course we know that there's wisdom, there's also warning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these people, because anybody that attacks the Nabi alayhi salam, Allah, the Nabi alayhi salam said in a hadith, وَمَنْ آذَانِي فَقَدْ آذَى اللَّهُ وَمَنْ آذَى اللَّهُ يُشَكَ أَيُّخُذَى. That the Nabi alayhi salam says, whoever tries to harm me, then it's almost as if he's harming Allah in that sense. But we know it's impossible to harm Allah. But what does it mean? Meaning you are looking for fire. You are placing yourself in a dangerous situation where you'll be destroyed completely by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what happened to Mansur ibn Ikrimah, that he completely lost the using of his fingers. And Quraysh sticked with us between, it was about the 7th year of revelation to the 10th year of revelation, that the whole boycott was upon the Nabi alayhi salam and his family. But there were some people that were compassionate towards the Nabi alayhi salam and their family in secret, because like we said, that anybody that had to do anything with Quraysh openly, with Banu Hashim or Banu Abdul Muttalib openly, then Quraysh would also cut or deal with them in a very hard or harsh way, like they dealt with the Sahaba of the Nabi alayhi salam. So there were some people that went in secret and tried to assist the Nabi alayhi salam, like for instance Hishab ibn Amr al-Amiri. Hishab ibn Amr al-Amiri used to take his camels or his sheep or his horses at least, fill them with the food, have everything on there with food, clothing, all of these things. And he would go on the outskirts of the camp of where Banu Hashim was and Abdul Muttalib was, and he would hit the horse or the donkey, whatever the case may be, and would run freely into the camp. And that is how they knew that somebody sending something. And of course, after it was narrated with what is Hisham ibn Amr al-Amiri. One of the people also that sent food specifically to Sayyidah Khadija and the Nabi alayhi salam was the cousin of Sayyidah Khadija, Hakim ibn Hazm. He was one of the people that also showed that compassion and that sympathy towards the Nabi alayhi salam and towards all of the people, at least the Ahlul Bayt of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in this period, in order to, let me say, make things easier. Because remember, on one side, the Nabi alayhi salam is facing this with his family. On the other side, the Sahaba have been tortured, they have been punished, they have been harmed. Because we know that majority of the people that entered Islam in the beginning were not ones like all of them, were not like Abu Bakr, all of them were not like Uthman, all of them were not like Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, these strong characters. No, a lot of them were weak in what sense that they had no family to stand up against Quraysh for them. They were not under the protection of any clan in that sense. So a lot of them were weak in that sense. And the Sahaba were facing torture. The Nabi alayhi salam and his family is facing hardship, dry desert for 3 years, no water, no food. And yet the Nabi alayhi salam now decides by the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was sent to him, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders the Nabi alayhi salam to order his companions to leave for the first hijrah. And where was the first hijrah? Not to Europe, not to America, not to any place that we find today that is first world, yani. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Nabi alayhi salam to send the first hijrah to Africa. Imagine Africa, that people think today and categorize Africa as a third world continent. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted that the first hijrah for the Muslimin was to Habasha, Ethiopia, Abyssinia as known today, Ethiopia at least as known today, which was called that time Abyssinia, to Habasha. Why? Because the Nabi alayhi salam is seeing how much harm is happening to the Sahaba, to Ahlul Bayt, and he sends them. And one of the people that is also sent word from Ahlul Bayt is Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, the uncle of the Nabi Muhammad, at least the cousin of the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they go to who? To Najashi. We know that the king's name was Najashi. That is how everybody knows him. But his name was Ashama ibn Abjar. Ashama ibn Abjar. This was the name of the king of Abyssinia at that time. And there was approximately about 11 men and 4 women that was sent to the king of Abyssinia. And there's a beautiful story behind the whole event. That of course, when Ja'far ibn Abi Talib and a lot of the other Sahaba like Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, they went through to Abyssinia, we know that Quraysh heard about this and they sent their ministers in order to convince Najashi to send them back. Now the Nabi alayhi salam sent them to Najashi. Why? Because he says that there is a king in that land that will never be unjust to anybody. That he is a king of justice. He is a king that sees to every person's right and haqq. So this is why the Nabi alayhi salam then orders the Sahaba and of those at Ahlul Bayt to go to the land of Abyssinia. Who is sent from Quraysh in order to convince the king to send back the Sahaba and Ahlul Bayt is Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu. Of course, he became Muslim after, but this is a period before he became Muslim. So Amr ibn al-As was sent to Habasha. Why was he sent? Because he was known as a guy that, let me say, when it came to logic and debating, he was the best. He could convince people. Why? Because he was smooth in the way that he spoke. He used a lot of example, he used a lot of logic in order to convince people about certain things. So they would always send Amr ibn al-As in order to be the delegate to for discussions and for arguments and so on. So he sends Amr ibn al-As to the king of Abyssinia, Najashi. And of course, in that time, before Amr ibn al-As becomes Muslim, he of course uses his relationship that he had a very close relationship with the people of Abyssinia, because he used to trade a lot within Africa, Egypt, Abyssinia, and all of these different places. So he tried to use that relationship that he had with Najashi in order to convince him to come. But Najashi, like we said, he was a king that stood upon justice. So he did not want to send them back until he gave them an opportunity to speak and vocal their case, to mention what is the thing, what is his stance, and so on. So Najashi brings the Sahaba and Ahlul Bayt in front of him, and of course Amr al-As is there as well, and he says, present your case. So Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, he is then placed forward by the Sahaba and Ahlul Bayt, and he starts to speak on behalf of them. So he says, Ayyuhal Malik, kunna qawman ahlu jahiliyya, na'budu al-aslam, wa na'kulu al-mayta, wa na'ti al-fawahish bil-fawahish, wa naqta' al-arham, wa nasi'u al-jiwar, ya'kulu al-kawiyu minna al-da'if, fa kunna ala thalika hatta ba'ath Allahu ilayna rasulan, minna نعرف نسبه وصدقه وأمانته وعفافه فدعانا إلى الله تعالى لتوحيده ونعبده وتعبده ونخلع ما كنا نعبد نحن وآباؤنا من دونه من الحجارة والأوثان وأمر بالصدق في الحديث وأداة الأمانة وصلة الرحم وحسن الجوار والكف عن المحارم والدماء ونهانا عن الفواحش وقول الزور وأكل مال اليتيم وقذف المحصنة. And of course, there is much more to it. But of the main points, and it's a very important message for us, Jamaat al-Muslimin, because today, a lot of people think that Islam is just by saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah, and you perform salah, you do siyam, you do zakah, you do hajj, and that is basically what the whole religion is about. And that is not the case. And here we see that in the beginning, because we need to go back to our basics. We need to go back to how the Sahaba was, how the Rabbi alayhi salam was. And look at this, he says, Oh my king, we were people of ignorance, that we used to worship idols that we created. وَنَأْكُلُ الْمَيْتَ And we used to eat the dead. وَنَأْتِ الْفَوَاحِشِ And we used to come to this corruption, and we used to indulge in it and all of these things. وَنَقْتَعُ الْأَرْحَامِ And we used to cut off family. Any reason they cut off family, you know, just like today, petty issues we find between each other, we decide that we're not going to speak anymore to our brothers or to our sisters or to our cousins, and even worse off to our parents. People find the most smallest things in order to cut off family, and that is one of the alamatul jahiliyah. That is one of the signs of ignorance, as Ja'far mentions that this is what they used to do. وَنَقْتَ الْأَرْحَامِ And we cut off family ties. وَنَسِيءُ الْجِوَارِ And we would harm our neighbors. وَيَأْكُلُ الْقَوِيُّ مِنَّ الضَّعِيفِ And the strong would eat up the weak, would oppress the weak. فَكُنَّ عَلَى ذَلِكَ حَتَّى بَعْثَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا We were upon that until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to us a messenger. We know his nasab, his lineage. We know his honesty. We know his trustworthy. We know exactly what he is and who he was, because they knew the Nabi alayhi salam as a sadiqul amin, the most honest and most trustworthy person. وَعَفَافَهُ And his purity. فَدَعَانَا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى لِنُوَحِّدَهُ So he called us to worship Allah alone and to see to the absolute uniqueness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَنَخْلَعْ مَا كُنَّا نَعْبُدُ نَحْنُ وَأَبَاؤُنَا مِنْ دُونِهِ مِنَ الْحِجَارَةِ And he ordered us to not worship any of what we and our fathers worship, and that was of course the idols that were made out of stone. وَأَمْرَ بِالصِّدْقِ And he ordered us to be truthful. Look at that, subhanallah, truthful في الحديث وأداء الأمانة and to make sure that we give over those things that we are entrusted with وصلة الرحم and we connect with our families, we connect with our brothers, our sisters, our family, our parents, our mothers, our fathers, we connect with them وحسن الجوار and to have good or be good towards our neighbors والكف عن المحارم والدماء and to stay away from approaching evil and what is haram and what is corrupt and also of slaughtering and killing and fighting. He ordered us to stay away from these things. وَنَهَانَ عَنِ الْفَوَاحِشِ And stay away from these corrupt things. وَقَوْلَ الزُّورِ And to lie and cheat. وَأَكْلُ مَالَ الْيَتِيمِ And he told us to stay away from eating the orphan's money. وَقَذْفِ الْمُحْصَنَةِ And to call other people, slander people that are pure, slander people that are innocent. He ordered us to stay away from all of these things. Now I ask you, Jamaat al-Muslimin, do we not find that a lot of the times we see that a lot of the Ummah of the Rabbi alayhi salam, إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبِّي Except for those that are in mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they still practice these things. These things are jahiliyyah things. These things are the days of ignorance. We are supposed to be in the days of nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we have no excuse. We know what is the haqq and we need to follow the haqq. Otherwise, Allah is going to question us on the day of Qiyamah. And look here, this is what he tells the king of Abyssinia. This is what the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had ordered us to do. So Amr ibn al-As, he feels that, you see, because Christianity in its essence, in its origin, also calls to love, it calls to compassion, it calls to mercy, it calls to standing up for the haqq. And Najashi, Amr ibn al-As starts to see that Najashi is kind of relating to what Ja'far is saying. So Amr ibn al-As then the next day in the debate, he says, give me another day and I'm going to make sure that you will be able to be convinced of these people. You have to send them away. So Amr ibn al-As the next day then decides to ask Najashi and tell Najashi, ask him about what do you think of Sayyidah Maryam, Mary, and Jesus Christ, and Masihu Isa ibn Maryam. So of course, the Malik, the king, asks. And Ja'far ibn Abi Talib then recites the ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمْ إِذْ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك إن كنت تقيا قال إنما أنا رسول ربك لأهب لك غلاما زكيا قالت أنى يكون لي غلام ولم يمسسني بشر ولم أك بغيا قال كذلك قال ربك هو علي هين ولنجعله آية للناس ورحمة منا وكان أمرا مقضيا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this holy ayat that has been recited now to Najashi in that event, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرُ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمْ, and mention in the book about Sayyidah Maryam alayhi salam. إِذْ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا, that she took and she secluded herself one side east away from people. Why? Because she was trying to relieve herself. Of course, going to the bathroom in that sense. فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا, so she made sure that she is covered and she's not seen by anybody. فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهَا رُوحَنَا, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we sent to her our messenger. Who was that? Jibreel alayhi salam. فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا سَوِيًّا, so he came in a form of a man, that he was a messenger to her from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when she saw the man, she immediately said, قالت إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك إن كنت تقيا, I seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from you if you have any source of taqwa, that you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, قال إنما أنا رسول ربك, he says, I am but a messenger from your Lord, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لأهب لك غلاما زكيا, so that I may inform you about a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the form of a son that will be pure, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you. And then of course, naturally, what does she say? She says, أَنَّا يَكُونُ لِي غُلَامٌ, how can I have a son? وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ, when no man has touched me, no man has married her, no man has ever had intercourse with her. And Jibreel alayhi salam, they says, قَالَ كَذَلِكَ, that is how Allah has decreed, and it is easy upon your Lord to decree and do these things. وَلِنَجْعَلَهُ آيَةً, and we'll make him as a sign to mankind. وَرَحْمَةً, and as a mercy to mankind. وَكَانَ أَمْرًا مَقْضِيًّا, and it's already been set out. And of course, Najashi, Amr ibn al-As is trying to prove, Najashi, that we believe something differently from the Christians, that we dishonor, we disgrace Isa, we disgrace Sayyidah Maryam, and that is a complete opposite. Islam honors and loves, and actually makes it of the arkan, the pillars of the iman, that you have to believe in Isa alayhi salam and his miraculous birth, that he's a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all of the miracles that he performed, whether it be that he raised the dead by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether he cured all the illnesses of that time, and all of these things, indeed he was a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Najashi is now listening to these ayat, and one of the riwayat mentions that Najashi starts to cry, and he says, إن هذا الذي جاء به نبيكم والذي جاء به عيسى لا يخرج من مشكات واحد. He says that wallahi, by Allah, by God, that what you brought from your Nabi and what Nabi Isa alayhi salam brought, it's almost as if these two messages came from one source. So at the end of the day, 3 years, and at that time, at least على رأس السنة الثالثة, upon the third year, there's a group of people of Quraysh and decides, and they say, no, you know what, this is bad, this is evil, this is not within us, because it was not within the Arabs to be so hard with each other, you know, with the Arabs, because they were all family at the end of the day. Cousin is a cousin of that, the second cousin of that, and so on like that. So some of the people from Bani Qusay, they then decide that we are not going to do this anymore, we're going to end this boycott. And they decide, and on top of them, the man that was the chief of them at least, Zuhair ibn Abi Umayyah, he then decides, he says, Ya Ahl Makkah, O people of Makkah, Anakulu Ta'am, do we eat food? Wanalbas al-thiyab, and we have our clothing. Banu Hashim halaka, and Banu Hashim is being destroyed. La yuba'una wa la yabta' minhum, that nobody is selling to them, neither is anybody buying from them. Wallahi la أقعد حتى تشك هذه الصحيفة القاطعة الظالمة. He then says, I will not stand still anymore, and I will not continue with this until the صحيفة, this paper, is completely, this agreement that we had, is completely destroyed and cut. So in that period, while this is happening, the Nabi alayhi salam is then revealed to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Jibreel, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals him that the sahifa, the paper that those conditions or those statements were written on, or the agreements that they had, was eaten by what? By the naml, by the ants. And the Nabi alayhi salam then informs his uncle Abu Talib, and Abu Talib goes to Quraysh and he tells him about the story, that indeed the Nabi alayhi salam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him that the whole scripture has been eaten except the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they go and they try to find out. So as they come in front of the door of the Kaaba, they found that the ant has eaten everything except the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abu Talib then says, Inna ibn akhi qad sadaq, then indeed the son of my brother has told the truth. Fa'afiku, wake up, warji'u min ansu ra'yukum, and do not go back to your ways with us and with the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fa'allahi la nusallimuhu hatta namuta man inda akhiruna. He says, wallahi, by Allah, we will not give him up, even if it be the last person that's standing of our family. We will protect the Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is how the boycott ends, because they see indeed that with Bani Qusay, and also by the indications or the proof that we find within the sahifa, the paper that has been eaten, it shows that indeed this is a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Quraysh then decides to end off the boycott upon Bani Hashim and Banu Abdul Muttalib. Inshallah, we continue the story in our next session and we'll extract some lessons from it, inshallah ta'ala. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim, wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.